First of all, I think a couple of thanks that are new.
First of all, the guy you saw holding the door for you, Alex Blanton, he is actually our host at Microsoft here. He has generously arranged for this location for us. The next thing is the Data Science Dojo organizing team, Fook, Janela, and Brian, Mona, and Caitlin. All of them, they did all the preparation for the meetup. And finally, the speaker, Muzamil Arai. I have known Muzamil for a long time now. I mean, he's been a friend for a long time. And he has been extremely busy because of this whole LIGO business that you may know about. So he has been extremely busy. I think he was in Caltech just until yesterday, I guess. And then he just arrived 2 hours ago, and he's flying out again 6 a.m. in the morning. I mean, so it was just my personal connection that we were able to actually get him to come and speak for us. So I would not waste any more time. I will just hand the mic to him. Just please welcome the speaker. Thank you.
Hello, good evening. My name is Muzamil Arai. Tanvir gave me a lot of credit. thank you for waiting. So we'll start about LIGO. Let's see, what is it all about? So this whole half second signal that you get, this is the whole story behind LIGO. And to me, it's incredible that something that started 40, 50 years ago, 30, 40 years ago, people started working on it, and the end product is this half second. So this shows that sometimes you need to make long-term commitments, and this is one of the good things about the science, the basic science that the government supports, that the output, you finally get the output. So let's switch gears and talk about the presentation. The first thing I want to mention is that I'm currently not associated with LIGO. I used to work at LIGO from 2005 to 2010. During the presentation, I'll describe briefly the organization of LIGO, that how, what is LIGO science collaboration, and what different terms that you may have heard. I was at University of Florida initially as a postdoc and then as a research scientist. From 2010 onwards, I've been working in industry in Bay Area. But LIGO was one of the best things that ever happened to me. I still have very nice connections with the folk who are running LIGO, and I keep myself up to date. So when Tanvir talked to me about the LIGO and the detection, it was and then it was a great honor to be here and present the work and on behalf of LIGO. But I must make it clear that this is not a presentation from LIGO. I'm not part of LIGO anymore. All the work that I will present is publicly available, and if you search on Google, you will be able to find it. Or I should say Bing, sorry. Top 10 references in the presentation, I used a lot of them, and then some other work that I did when I was at University of Florida. So this is not just my own personal work, but work of the whole collaboration. This voice that you heard, that's basically a chirp. And this is exactly what happens. This probably lasted about half a second or so. But this is what we hear when something big happens in the universe. That's what I call the melody of the universe. Two stars collided together more than a billion years ago, and now after about a billion years afterwards, you can listen that how they actually collided with each other and created more stars. And that's how the universe started. So what are gravitational waves? Gravitational waves are ripple in space-time. They interact with matter by displacing it, and they allow the study of black holes, and they can shed light on Big Bang. They pass through almost everything unaffected. That's one of the reasons we want to study them, because they have not been polluted by any other events in the universe. This is how gravitational waves how can you estimate the magnitude of gravitational wave? H is the gravitational wave constant, or the gravitational wave magnitude, and basically you can think of gravitational waves as an equivalent of electromagnetic waves. This is how LIGO works, and I guess that's pretty much it. The reason I put these three slides in there, I gave a talk about LIGO at my current place, Carl Zeiss Meditech, and I started with these slides. And the reaction I got was just the reaction that I just received. Then I realized that I should start from the basic. And so I'll try to go from the beginning and try to connect it with the equations that you are familiar with. And then at the end, when we'll go through these two slides again, you might have a better understanding what gravitational waves are. Everyone can predict what it might be? Any volunteer? Who could this person be? Newton. Good. So basically, Newton is the one who started giving us some equations and some frame of reference where we can model the world. Different things that happen, for example, if I push something, if I push a car, if I bounce bounce a ball on the ground, it comes back. All these things, Newton is the one who basically started what we call Newtonian physics. These are the three famous laws of motion. An object remains in a state of uniform motion, tends to remain in that state unless an external force is applied to it, which applies to most of people as well. People have inertia. Second law is more important. This gives us the mathematical background. I'm sure most of you in the class in this room are familiar with F is equal to ma. So Newton was the first one who put an equation to how different objects react to a force when a force is applied to it. And finally, the third law of motion, every action, there is an equal and opposite reaction. I'm sure all of you are familiar with it. Let's talk about Newton's second law. Basically, you hit an object. If this green arrow represents the direction of the force, the object is moving in the same direction. The reason that this object is stopped is because of the friction. If there was no friction, if you have started an object, it will continue. Once it reaches steady state, then it will continue moving in the steady state direction. Basically, this is the basics of all the mechanics and statics and dynamics that we study. Most of the equations are derived from here. These three equations, I hope that most of you are familiar with it. The interesting thing to note here is that you can predict what happens to an object if it's under a force. You can predict the velocity of that object. You can predict how much distance this object will move if you give it an initial push. I don't think so that I'll need to explain this. I'm sure that most of you are familiar with this one. So a car moves, you can start, if there is an acceleration involved when you turn on your engine, the initial velocity is zero. Based on how much force you put on the engine, the car will move, and you can predict Newton's equations. You can use Newton's equations to basically model the behavior and predict what's happening. Here is another example. As you can see that now here we are showing that there are two objects which are moving in with different velocities. And if you are an observer, you will see that one of the objects is moving slowly, another object is moving fast, and the observer will see the exact speed that the two cars are moving at. Now, things get interesting if I put the observer on the second car. Now, what will happen? If the observer is actually sitting on the second car, what do you think the velocity will be, the velocity that this person will measure of the first object? Any takers? So this, sorry? How much? 20. And why would that be? Because it's a subtractive process, because the observer himself is moving, so the amount of speed that he himself is moving, you have to subtract it out, and you can put it using some equations, and you can actually subtract this out. So this is called transformation of directions or transformation of different coordinates. So you, in this case, what you are doing, you are basically relating the distance with the velocity and time. So this means that, and we saw already that Newton's law of motion gives you a means to correlate the velocity, distance traveled with time. So basically, all this is happening that if the observer is sitting on the second car, then all he sees is the relative motion. So Newton's physics is basically relative, depending on the person, depending on the observer. If you are observing the universe from here, then what you see is relative motion from wherever you are standing. This is called Galilean transformation. By the way, if you have any questions, feel free to ask me or stop me. I tend to speak a bit fast. Another thing that Newton did was he created this famous equation. And I hope that most of you know, remember this equation, that this is Newton's law of universal gravitational motion. In other words, by using this equation, you can predict how different objects move in the universe, how Earth moves around the sun, how suns rotate in an orbit. So you see the connection that starting from three very basic equations, which are very easy to understand, you can predict how the universe behaves. You can predict how the sun rotates how the Earth rotates around its orbit. And basically what Newton said, that there is a force that exists between two bodies. If they have a certain mass, then those two objects will be attracted to each other by the force which is given by this. It's inversely proportional to the distance between them, directly proportional to the masses. So the heavier the body is, the more massive the force will be. So that's why we can walk on Earth. If you throw a ball upward, it comes down because of the gravity. So far, I guess, it's pretty routine stuff. But before Newton, there was some people who actually looked at the different orbits, and then they came up with this idea that you can predict the time a certain satellite, a certain object, a certain planet will take to go around the sun by using these equations, and it's directly proportional to the distance between them. So if you equate the Newton's law of gravitation with the equation that we saw a little while ago, F is equal to ma, you can verify this equation. That's why what Newton did was very important, that starting from very simple equations where you can predict how objects move when you push them or when you apply the force, and how the initial velocity and the final velocity are related, how the distance are related. Using those simple equations, you can actually predict how the universe behaves. You can predict how much time our Earth will take to rotate around the sun, how much time it will take to go on its axis. And that was revolutionary. Before that, people have used observations. They would have to count the days, that how many after how many days they actually see a certain planet again, after how many days they will see a certain star at a certain location. And everyone, depending on how accurate their observation was, everyone will come up with different answers. But Newton was the first who actually provided a mathematical background that you can actually predict all these big events that happen in the universe. And I think it was a very revolutionary idea that back 1,500 years ago, 400-500 years ago, that when there were no computers, there was nothing, even then mankind was able to predict how the universe is actually working. So, but there were certain limitations of Newtonian mechanics. One of the thing which came up very often was Newton's law of gravitation. You just saw it's based on two masses. So it's proportional to the masses of two objects. It's inversely proportional to the distance between them. But what happens if there are three objects? So for example, in this case, object one and object two, for example, if these are two balls, they will attract each other. They will also be attracted by the Earth. So actually solving this equation is non-trivial, because then which force to use, what distance to use. People have tried, they have come up with solutions for limiting case, but it cannot be solved for a journal arbitrary case. That was one of the limitations that came afterwards. Another phenomena that we actually see is bending of the light around the sun. And you can actually see it if you are looking at a star which is around the sun. People observe this phenomena very well when there is a solar eclipse. At that time, you can actually see that the rays of light actually bend around the sun. And Newton actually had to, some people afterwards, they tried to correct Newton's formula by applying a cubic term and by applying a four term, but still the magnitude that they were able to get, they could not correctly predict how much light bending exists. This is, again, a very revolutionary idea that something like light can be affected by gravity, or something like light that at that time was considered a force, something that cannot be altered by any easier means, will actually be attracted by light. At that time, no one thought that light could have a mass. If there is no mass of the light, how will light be attracted to gravity? And that was a big puzzle, because people thought that light could be particles, light could be waves. So depending on your thought process, if you consider light was wave, then this was something that you could not explain. Then there were some calculations done to measure the orbit of Mercury, and that was and by using Newton's law of gravitation, you could not pinpoint exactly the radius of the orbit of the Mercury planet. There is some interesting story behind that. That when the Saturn, Neptune were predicted, people initially thought that Saturn is the last planet. And after, but when they observed the orbit of Saturn carefully, they found that it's not, if you apply Newton's law of gravitation, it actually predicts that the it does not follow the law. And the orbit is actually slightly different than what you would expect. And this led them to believe that there must be another planet after Saturn, and that's how they actually discovered Neptune. Because from the Newton's law, it was not following Newton's law, and that what they meant, then they predicted that only the attraction between the sun and the rest of the stars cannot predict how long does Saturn take to go around the sun. That's why they thought there must be another star after Saturn that must be doing this, because of the three-body problem I mentioned. They could not predict it exactly, but they knew that there must be something. And that's how they first discovered Neptune. And once they know how the Neptune was working, and then they were able to predict that there must be another star, another planet afterwards. Now everything remains nice, apart from these small limitations. Most of the stuff that we see in our life follows Newton's law. But some funny things happen when the objects which are moving are reaching closer to the speed of light. So these are some equations. Some of you might have seen them, some of you might not. But basically, I'll get back to them in a minute. But what special relativity does, special relativity is the theory that Einstein predicted in 1905. It was the initial step to the general relativity. And it basically, it's a stepping stone between these two theories. It tells you a little bit more about the universe. And it is basically a special case of general relativity. And it predicts what happens when the motion of the object is closer to the speed of light. It predicts that the mass will increase. If something is moving with a speed which is closer to the speed of light, the mass will increase. The length will contract, and the time will also go through contraction. In other words, mass is not constant anymore. And this is, again, it put people's life upside down. Before, mass is a constant. Mass does not change. Mass was a fundamental quantity. Earth's mass is not changing. So that's why the gravitational force exerted by the Earth must not be changing. But here, someone else comes in, and he tells them that the mass can actually increase if you move with higher velocity. The length will shorten, And this gave people a lot of ideas about time travel. I'm sure you have seen that, how people predict that the time travel is possible. So they basically manipulate these equations and then create scenarios where you can time travel. But apart from that, if you think about the transformation, if you recall the last transformation we talked about, where simply the distance could change depending on the observer. If the observer was moving, then the speed he will monitor, the other car that he was monitoring, he will see the difference of speed, not the absolute speed. But here, what Einstein was able to do, he was able to generalize these equations and put them in this format, where the difference is that now the speed, relationship of the speed of the observer with respect to the light speed matters. That if the observer or if the object is moving with speed closer to the speed of light, then these things will happen. To give you an example, for example, if this is an observer, he wants to measure the length of the car. How will he measure it? One interesting thing that you can think about is you can only get information at the speed of light. You cannot get information at more than the speed of light. So you can imagine that this guy sends one laser at this end, another laser at this end, and the distance between them, you can relate the angle between them, and from the angle, you can predict what might be the distance, what might be the length of this car. Let's say that this is the initial length of this car. Now let's see if this car is somehow moving with the speed which is closer to the speed of light. Now you will see that the length he measures is different. Why would it happen? And this is, basically put the original one back. The reason it happens that initially he tested the front of the car, then he's checking the rear end of the car. By that time, the car has already moved. And this could only happen if that car is moving with speed which is closer to the speed of light. If the car, in general, if the car is moving 100 miles an hour, 200 miles an hour, doesn't make a difference because the speed of light is so fast compared to the motion of the car that he will not see this effect, that the length actually decreases. So length is easier to understand. Same thing happened to mass. Same thing happens to the time that that you measure. If the observer was measuring the time, how much time did it take for the car to move this one, this will also change if the speed of the car is closer to speed, the speed of light. So this is another, I'm trying to maybe, sometimes people say if you have a question on the slide, it puts people to sleep. But let's see how much equations can we deal with it here. But this basically tells you that you can go from four dimensions. X, Y, Z are familiar X, Y, Z dimensions, the three dimensions that we see. The four dimension is time. So basically, we live in a four-dimensional space. So this, what Einstein's equation does, they take these four dimensions, and they tell you if you are moving with certain speed, what will happen to your mass, what will happen to the distances, and then you can apply all the laws that we studied before. F is equal to ma is still valid. So you can apply those equations. If you take into account the difference in length, the difference in mass, and the difference in the time that you are measuring it for. What would this be? So this is hydrogen plus oxygen making two water molecules. So if you actually look at this, this is another interesting thing that Einstein predicted. He said that mass and energy are equivalent. They are related to each other. Mass is technically slightly wrong to say that mass can be converted to energy and energy can be converted to mass. But ultimately, this is, for all practical purpose, this is what's happening. So you have two molecules of hydrogens. They are reacting with a molecule of oxygen to make two molecules of hydrogen. If you carefully measure them, what will you find? You will find this, that the mass of individual atoms, if you take the mass of each atom and then add them with the mass of oxygen, and then weigh these two molecules, there will be a difference in mass. So this means, although we are familiar with the term that energy can neither be created nor destroyed, mass can neither be created nor destroyed. However, it can change its shape. That's exactly what's happening. The initial mass of this system was higher. Then when they formed the two molecules of hydrogen, the mass got reduced. And that reduced mass was actually the reason that was needed to, now that difference in mass, according to this equation, this is the amount of energy now you will need to spend to break the hydrogen molecules. Or another way of saying that is that this was the amount of energy that was given off as heat when the molecule formed. Now, this is again a revolutionary concept. This means heat had mass. That was the only conclusion you would draw from it, that heat actually had mass. And when these two molecules were combined together, that mass subtracted away. That's why I was saying sometimes it's technically incorrect to say mass can be converted to energy, or mass can be, energy can be converted to mass. Another way to look at is that heat actually had mass. So now that amount of mass has been converted into basically that heat left the system. Anyways, so we started from transform of coordinates that you can predict from the motion of the bodies. From there, we discussed that based on if the speed of the objects involved are comparable to speed, the usual transformation doesn't work, and you have to take into account the speed difference. And then Einstein came up with this idea that mass and energy are somehow related by this equation, where c is the speed of light. Now, after 1905, Einstein was still not very happy because he could not predict where the gravity comes from. All these equations we talk about, there was no mention of gravity, that what is the origin of gravity? So he was really bothered by that. So he started thinking, how can I incorporate the concept of gravity or the force of gravity into a mathematical framework which can deal both with how the mass moves and how the gravity functions. So in 1915, he formulated his field equations, where he mentioned that the geometry of space-time is influenced by matter and radiation. In other words, that the four-dimensional universe that we see can be changed if a massive object comes closer to it. And now you can relate all those things that you have heard about black holes, that black holes are something that even the light cannot escape. And that's precisely this reason that those black holes, their mass is so intense, their mass density is so intense that they change fundamentally the space around them. They change them so much that even the light does not escape. So with this simple statement, you can predict the formation of black holes. You can predict how different stars collide with each other. This is a very famous statement that many people mention, that mass tells the space how to bend, and space tells the mass how to move. We'll see a practical example of that in a few slides. So here you can see what's happening, that when you are, we just mentioned that according to Newton's law, things move in a straight line. You put a force on them, the objects move in the direction. But if you think globally, by globally I mean if you think about the curvature of the Earth, so for example, if someone pushes me, I'm moving in a straight line, but I'm actually not moving in a straight line. I'm moving on a curved surface. And this is an interesting idea to think about, that the dimensions are actually influenced by Earth, because the straight line is not a straight line. For Newton, it was a straight line, but if you look on the larger scale, that's why this happens, that if you start from the equator, parallel lines remain parallel lines in ordinary mass. If these two surfaces are parallel, they are not going to converge together and meet at the same time. But yet, if you start from equator with a distance between you, if you continue in a straight line, you will collide at the North Pole. So this means, again, that the initial idea that bodies will continue in a straight line is not correct. But what they do is they move under the influence of Earth, in a curved line. And that's exactly what the general theory of relativity predicts, that now the space has been changed by mass. So the presence of Earth actually makes the straight line, instead of a straight line, that straight line has to follow the curvature of Earth. So that's, in other words, mass is telling the space how to bend, and then the space is telling telling the person or me or any object how to move. Putting some more mathematics behind that, you have seen these transformations before. Initially, we started with Newton's law, where we were relating distances and time. Then we started incorporating special theory of relativity, where we started incorporating the absolute the velocity of the object, and mentioned that if the velocity of the object is very high, things change. And then finally, Einstein predicted these, that these are again the 4x4 matrices, that the four dimensions, x, y, z, and time, are not only affected by speed of light, they are also affected by the mass which is around them. So that's the main postulate of general theory of relativity. And now, suddenly, the gravity is not a force. Gravity is not a force, but rather, it's the ability of a mass to tell a matter around it how to move. The example that I gave before, that we can example that I mentioned, that if an object is moving on a straight line on Earth, basically what's happening is following a curved path, and it's following a curved path because of the existence of the Earth. Now Earth is telling me that when I need to move in a straight line, it's actually a curved line. And you can generalize from here, if the object is more massive, then the amount of curvature will be more and more and more. And that's exactly what happens in black holes. When, if instead of Earth, this was a black hole, the space, I mean, you can think of this fabric as a further away from mass, it's kind of uniform. But as you move closer and closer to the object, if this was a black hole, this whole space will be curved so much that the light will never come back. And you can think of this in terms of Earth as well. If the curvature is so much that as soon as the light tries to move, it will go back down originally, because that object will be attracting actually the light itself. And this is another part of Einstein equation, where he, instead of using gravity as a force, he started talking about the densities. So now what we are doing, we are relating the mass to the object and how they move. And that's ultimately, that was Einstein's goal, to be able to relate how mass interacts with different objects. If you have been following gravitational waves, this equation appears very often. Let's revisit this in a minute again. Basically, Einstein predicted that, I guess I'll skip this mathematics. But ultimately, what it's telling you, if you put this, if you take this equation, people who are familiar with differential equation, this makes a differential equation. If you solve the differential equation, then you get that there are gravity waves that happens. That if something big happens in the universe, basically it changes the space-time fabric, or in other words, it changes the curvature of the straight line. So, for example, if the Earth was moving very fast on its axis, and if it was not exactly symmetrical, you will see that slowly the curvature could change. It will the mass of the Earth will get reduced. It will start contracting. Now, if the Earth will start contracting, this means originally, if let me see if I can draw it. So, for example, if initially this was Earth and there was an object which was moving on a smaller scale, which is moving in a straight line like here, if the Earth is getting smaller and the gravity, the mass is getting masser, is more, then the curvature will be larger. Now, the same object with the same force will move differently, with a different curvature. So in other words, that the mass will influence that how an object will move. And depending on if there are more than one masses together, they change the space around them. And using this theory, suddenly, now we can explain the bending of lights exactly. Einstein, what predicted was how the amount of light that Einstein mentioned, will the light will bend. You can actually see that's exactly the amount of light that the light bends. Gravitational lensing is an interesting phenomena. And this, again, you can see it clearly when there is a solar eclipse. You can see any star which is between the line of sight, which is further away from sun, between on the other direction from which we are looking at it, it will, you will see more than one images of that. And that happens because some of the light will bend around it, and then will reach us, we'll see more than one image of that galaxy. And this also explains the formation of black holes, because when two stars start merging together, they will basically create the space which is so intense, the attraction of the space-time curvature is so much that the light will not come back. And again, he predicted the gravitational waves also. Everything else he mentioned has been proved except the gravitational wave. This was the, more or less the last unproven postulate of Einstein's theory. I guess after spending about half an hour, we'll actually talk about LIGO now. Now the familiar equation again. Now you can see where did it come from. This equation, H is the amount of strain. This is the amount of space-time ripple, or how much the, for example, if you were to take a uniform grid, I think I have an example of this. If this, whenever these gravitational waves will come, you will see if initially it was a square box. When these gravity waves will come, it will distort this object, that it, the length will increase in one direction, and then the width will increase in the other direction. So these are two different types of gravity waves that are generated that comes from the mathematics. They have different polarization, but the main message here is whenever these gravitational waves are created, they distort the space-time in such a way that if length increases in one direction, the width will decrease in the other direction, and vice versa. And sometimes, if you have seen the news, people mention that gravitational waves are ripple in space-time fabric, and this is exactly what I mean. If we were to represent the x, y, z, and time on this plate, then if nothing happens, the distance between these two ends will remain same if no force x on it. Their relationship with respect to time will not change. But if you can imagine that if a heavy object, if they are revolving around each other, then if this fabric will change its direction depending on how they are moving. If there is a heavy object thrown right in the middle, it will curve your fabric like that. And that's exactly what happens when gravitational waves come in. Then the four dimensions we are familiar with, x, y, z, and time dimension, they change depending on where the waves are coming from. That's a historical fact that Einstein predicted this, and he was not, initially he was very sure that gravitational waves existed, but in 1936 he thought that maybe they do not exist. So he was somewhat hesitant in that. But fortunately, there were people who were sure that his theory was correct, especially the gentleman on the left-hand side. So he convinced Einstein that his theory is correct, and Einstein did not publish another paper. He actually wanted to retract that, but some of his colleagues convinced him that his original theory is correct. Now I'll switch gears a little bit and talk about waves. So far we have been talking about gravity and gravitational waves, but what is a wave? A wave can be expressed like this. A wave has an amplitude, a wave has a period, and it changes its shape, or it goes up and down in a cyclic fashion. And the waves interfere with each other, they get out of phase, they get, if you add them together, the waves will basically increase in magnitude. If they are out of phase, they will decrease in magnitude. One interesting example that you can, most of you must have seen, if you throw two different stones in water, in lake or something, then they start creating the waves. And when wherever they merge together, you will see that the crust and you will have the amplitude will increase. At some point, you will see the dip, the rise and the dip. And that's basically two waves interfering with each other depending on the phase that they have. I had I hope this works. So for example, this is an example of how waves can interfere constructively. There are two waves, red and light blue one, and they add together. When they add together, right now there is no phase between them. You get the white curve, so you get maxima when the two curves are at maxima. But when you start changing the phase, then the addition of these, they interfere destructively, and you could actually get destructive interference. And that's how we actually detect the gravity waves. I'll explain a little bit more. Back to our original example again, if there is a phase shift between them, if they are moving with different velocity, so one car will travel more than the other one. And that's actually, LIGO uses this principle that it shoots light in two different directions. The light goes to two different mirrors. If one mirror is moving differently than the other one, then you can the phase difference between them changes and you can detect them. I think I had a video that explains it beautifully. So here you can see that the light is coming, light is being sent from one laser. It hits a mirror, the light gets reflected on both directions. And here is a wave example. So you can think of light as wave. Light gets divided at the beam splitter, which is a partially reflecting mirror. It hits one mirror, comes back, and then recombine. When they recombine, you put the distances such that they are out of phase. That is, when they add together, when the light adds together, there is no signal at the photodetector. But let's see what happens if the gravity wave comes. If gravitational wave comes in, one mirror will move in one direction, as we just saw. Another mirror will move in the opposite direction, and the phase between them will change. And your photodetector, if you have a photodetector is a device that converts light into electrical signal. So the electrical signal, the amount of electrical signal will change depending on how much the mirror is moving. And that's exactly what LIGO is doing. Well, not exactly. This is a simplified version of a simplified operation of LIGO. Now let's talk a little bit more about the origin of gravitational waves, that when and how these gravitational waves are generated. Gravitational waves started generating after a very brief moment after the Big Bang. These gravitational waves were generated when the universe was expanding, when the initial stars were forming, when big galaxies were forming. And one thing you will notice that the gravitational wave that we have that we are showing here, the magnitude is not changing. This is because the property of the gravitational waves that they can pass through any object without any hindrance. Because these are nothing but change in space. So what happens when the gravitational waves will pass through, for example, this table, for the amount of time when the gravity waves is interacting with it, the length will increase, the width will decrease, and this will go on. As soon as the gravitational waves will pass through, the object will come back to the space, and nothing itself will happen to the gravitational wave, because these will not be absorbed. They are not like light, that when they pass through different material, they will get absorbed or reflected. The reason gravitational waves gives us an better way to look at the universe is because we can look further down. This graph tells you can only look at 380,000 years after the Big Bang using the light, because light cannot go further back. Images that you get from Hubble telescopes or different observatories, you can only get information till here, but not further down. But with the gravitational wave, you can check what will happen what happened before that. another phenomena of gravitational wave is their frequency, that these gravitational waves have a certain frequency, and that determines what kind of gravitational waves can we detect on Earth. This tells you that when neutron star and black holes, they merge together, they create gravitational waves. These gravitational waves move with the speed of light, but they have a frequency of the order of about 100 hertz, or starting from 20, 30 hertz, all the way in the kilohertz region. When these big, compact, very compact stars merge together, as the mass increases, the frequency decreases. And when the Big Bang happened, from the Big Bang, the cosmic microwave background radiation that came in had a much smaller and smaller frequency. So basically, the principle is the more massive the object is, the frequency will be smaller and smaller of the gravitational waves. I will not torture you through mathematics again, but basically gravitational waves, the equation that we saw, it depends on the mass of the two objects which are involved. If you have two objects which are revolving around each other, they create a gravitational wave, and the magnitude is actually very small. If you put some numbers behind that, it's actually 10 raised to the power minus 17. These kind of, so there are some assumptions that a certain mass of stars which collide together, they will produce a distance which is 10 raised to the power minus 17. If you know a little bit about exponential notation, this is so small, I will have difficulty in explaining how small this number is. I thought I had an example of how small this number is. Maybe not. But this is basically, this number is so small that it's about 1,000th of a diameter of a proton. It's kind of very difficult to even claim that you can detect a motion which is so small in number. Now we'll talk a little bit more about what kind of events create gravitational waves. One of the example is that the example that we mentioned before, when two black holes merge together, they create something like this. Let me increase the volume so that you can hear what actually it does. So you will hear something like this. This is the famous chirp that LIGO actually detected. And this is more or less, if you were to listen to the gravitational wave, this is what you will hear. But the problem is you cannot hear it because the effect is so small that your ears will never be able to detect them. And this is how they look like, that initially they start with some frequency and the frequency increases, and that's what created a chirp. Then there are some events which are called bursts. If something, this is not a very well understood phenomena. Here what happens if, for example, if a star is forming from at the end of its life, it will create a burst of energy. So it's not a symmetrical thing, like you start with a certain sinusoidal frequency and it will sound something like this to you. Just a blip. So basically, some big event happens in the universe and you'll be able to detect a blip. This is difficult to measure because you don't know what kind of signal you are looking at. Then there will be a continuous source, just like microwave background. So this is what is remaining from the Big Bang. And this will sound something like, so it's just a general background. People who may have heard about microwave cosmic background, microwave background, if you point your microwave detectors in different directions, you will always see this chatter. And this chatter is from the Big Bang. The same thing will happen to the gravitational waves, but the amount of gravitational wave that will be produced by this is very small. So LIGO is still not there where we can actually detect this. I'll skip this. Another interesting example is these pulsars. These pulsars are interesting planets which are they are around Earth and they are all scattered all over the universe. And what they do, they are called pulsars because they create a light. They create a signal that you can actually hear. This is more like a magnetic signal. So, microwave signal that you can hear, and it acts like a beacon. So for example, you can imagine, you can think of as a light wave on a light tower. Normally they have a light that revolves around it, and these neutron stars produce these pulsars, and you can exactly pinpoint after how much time you will actually find these pulsars, or when you will detect them on the Earth. In 1973 or around about there, two scientists working on that is there is an observatory in Puerto Rico, which was famous, made famous by James Bond movie, because I remember there was a fight on the actual detector of the of this observatory. They actually heard this. They listened to this, and they actually observed these radio signals. That these radio signals are coming, and what he found interesting, that the frequency or the time interval between them is changing, and that was exactly what Einstein predicted. That when there are two stars which are close to each other, when they start revolving around each other, then they radiate energy, and you will, and they will slowly the orbit will change. Probably you have seen those things that sometimes you people put in charity events where you can launch two different coins from two different ends of opposite ends of each other, and the coins start circling each other, and they ultimately go down. This is exactly what happens when two stars collide with each other. They start at a distance, they start revolving around each other, and that's why you hear a chirp. As they get closer and closer and closer, the frequency increases, and then you can hear, you hear a chirp. But the amount of gravitational wave that was predicted by this was very small. So you have an indirect proof of gravitational waves exist, but you were not, scientists were not able to actually predict that. And scientists have predicted that this will take them still about several million years because they are actually a bit further away from each other. After a million years, their magnitude will be so much that we will be able to detect them. Right now, they are further away, so the gravitational wave, there is indirect proof that they create gravitational waves, but we cannot detect them. This is what we used to call at LIGO, nature's joke with LIGO. So there is another pulsar that does that that exists, that people actually looked at it and they found there is another pulsar here. The interesting thing about this pulsar is this frequency, that the frequency at which it emits the chirp is 59.8. If you have an electrical background, you know that in US the frequency of light that we use is 60 hertz. This is so close to 60 hertz, and at 60 hertz, because of this, that we always have noise from the electrical power systems, it's very difficult to isolate this in LIGO data. So that's why we used to call it nature's joke with LIGO. Given a certain mass, LIGO started with initial LIGO, and then now what is operating is what we call advanced LIGO, and roughly LIGO can see about a billion years into the space or into the universe. Now let's see, what is LIGO? This is more about the organization of LIGO. There is, after LIGO detected gravitational waves, there were a number of terms thrown out, LIGO, LVC, LSC. So this is how they are related to each other. Basically, LIGO lab, LIGO laboratory is more or less like Lincoln's laboratory that was created by National Science Foundation initial funding. So LIGO laboratory is the one that actually runs both both observatories that we have in US. And then after a certain while, MIT and Caltech, they thought that this project is so big that only those two institutes will not be able to handle this. So they started collaborating with different, this slide is somewhat out of date. I think there are more than 50 US institutes now. So they started collaborating with different universities, and they formed something called LSC, LIGO Science Collaboration. They had collaboration with different countries which are contributing in terms of analysis, in terms of part. National Science Foundation was the main institute that was giving them, that was providing the funding. And if I'm not mistaken, roughly it's more than $1 billion, more than half a billion to $1 billion that they have spent on LIGO since LIGO started. These are different universities which are in, which are involved in LIGO, and I used to work at University of Florida. So it was Gator Country. Timeline of LIGO. That's an interesting thing that someone actually thought of LIGO in 1970s. There was a professor at MIT who thought about this, that we can actually detect that, and he proposed that in 1972. So people are working on LIGO since 1972, when I was not even born. So there were certain milestones after going through all this. The first LIGO was operational in 1999, and finally on September 14, 2015, LIGO made the discovery and announced that we have actually detected the gravitational waves. If you are interested more how LIGO is actually more or less now international organization, in a sense that it has collaborations with other institutes. There are gravitational wave observatories all over the world. In US, there are two observatories. One is in Livingston, and another one is in Hanford. Can anyone, one of you, tell me that is there something unique about this arrangement, that Livingston is here, Hanford is there? Why would that be? Why would you want to put them far away from each other? Great, great. That's exactly the reason why they put it as far as possible on US, so that anything happens in Livingston does not happen in Hanford. And the amount of motion that you're trying to detect is incredibly small. If they are close together, how can you isolate what happens, whether it's coming from a truck passing by or a train passing by? Actually, I used to work at Livingston, and unfortunately, 5 miles, about 10, 15 miles away, there was a train track. And every time at 7 a.m. sharp, when the train will arrive, the LIGO interferometer will go out of log, because the motion of that train transmitted to the ground 15 miles away was so much that the instrument couldn't handle it. That's how sensitive the LIGO interferometer is. And it can actually, you can see the effect of tidal motion on 14th of the moon. You could actually see that the noise floor goes up whenever there is 14th of the moon. Anyhow, so these two sites were selected, and they have a certain time difference, how much time the light will take. We know that the gravitational waves move with the speed of light. So the difference between the time that it will take for light to travel from here to here is 10 milliseconds. That's another indication that if you detect something at two different sites, which you detected exactly 10 milliseconds apart or somewhere around 10 milliseconds apart, this will guarantee that it's a gravitational wave and it's not a false signal. That, for example, it could be an earthquake here now, and after 5-10 minutes, there is an earthquake there at Livingston. And that's how you can basically isolate different events that happen on Earth from when the actual gravitational waves will arrive. And then there is a whole list of different observatories. So apart from US, there is one which was started in Germany. There is another one in Italy. There is another one planned for Japan. And there was another one planned for LIGO, Australia. It's a question mark because they didn't get funding from the government. This is a copy from 1972, original proposal by Professor Ray Weiss, who initially started the concept of LIGO. And there was another professor from Caltech, Ron Draver. And I think these two gentlemen, they will be the one, if LIGO receives the Nobel Prize, these two gentlemen or another professor, they will be the one who will get it. This is how LIGO works. We already saw that what is interferometer. This simulation you already saw. Let's say that when the gravitational wave come in, these two mirrors will move. So if you can detect the motion of the mirror, you can detect gravitational waves. But as I mentioned before, that the motion is so small that you cannot detect it. What people do is we put two mirrors in there. Now the reason we put two mirrors in there, remember the earlier cartoon that I showed in terms of car. When two cars are moving with different speed, they will arrive at a different point. Now, same concept applies. Let's say that we have two mirrors here, and then same two mirrors here. When the light goes back and forth, let's say at some point this distance is L, and this distance is L1. Now, if the light travels one time, it will detect L1 minus L. If the light can travel second time, it can detect two times L1 minus minus L. If the light travels three times, it will travel, it will measure it three times. So that's why there are mirrors in there. Basically, the reflectivity of the mirror is so that the light actually travels about 400, 500 times before it hits the mirror back again. So that's how you increase the sensitivity to the mirror motion by putting two mirrors instead of one mirror. That was not enough. So what they did was to increase the power even further, they put another mirror in there so the light goes back again after interfering. That was not enough, so they put a second mirror that whenever the gravitational waves will come, that gravitational wave signal will go back. So that's how many times the light goes back and forth between different mirrors so that we can detect this small amount. I guess the rest of there are basically, I mean, if I pick up any system of LIGO, I could spend an hour on each individual one, but that's basically how the gravitational wave observatory works. It's basically a 4 kilometer long. Oh, I guess I didn't mention it before. That was an interesting part. The longer the length is, because this is a change in length, this is not an absolute length, the longer the length is, the difference the mirror will move will be smaller. That, sorry, please.
The gravitational waves, it causes space itself to contract a little bit, right? So wouldn't that cause the wavelength of the light to change perceptibly?
But what you are, very good question. I knew that question will come. But what we are using the light only for the only as a probe. So if the light wavelength changes, all that matters is the phase difference between them, not the wavelength. So the phase difference, what you are after is the phase difference, not the absolute value of the wavelength. So each mirror is about 40 kilogram, and these mirrors are basically hanging from fibers. It's probably one of the biggest vacuum. The reason that it has to be in vacuum is because of the noise, that you have to eliminate the noise from different sources. This tells you how different noise sources act. Basically, how you suspend the mirror is the biggest contributing factor to the noise. OK, here is my slide that I wanted to show early. If, let's imagine that this is 1 meter. You divide it by 10,000, that's what you get, about 100 microns. That's the width of the human hair. Here, the light of wavelength is roughly about 1 micron. Then you divide the wavelength of light by another 10,000, you get the diameter of an atom. From there, another 100,000, you get the nuclear diameter. And from there, another 1,000, and you get the sensitivity of LIGO. That's how small LIGO can detect. And apart from these suspension noise and trains passing by, nature has not been very convenient either. And this is an actual photo. Sometimes this could happen too. And bugs too. At University of Florida, we were actually trying, because the amount of laser power that we actually use is very high. It's about 200 watt in a very small diameter. And wherever it passes, it can burn a lot of things. So we wanted to see at one point, for example, if a bug somehow gets into the, everything is in vacuum, but initially the main laser is outside the vacuum, and that light has to go inside the vacuum. So we were worried about if a bug comes in, what will happen? So we did an experiment, and no bug was harmed. The bug was already dead when we took it. So we put it there, shined about 200 watt light on it, and then this is what happened. It actually made some cracks on it. So, and from then on, it was decided that LIGO vacuum will be covered by two windows. So it will be sealed so that if one breaks, at least we have the second window. And this is what happens, actually, if you put 200 watt light on a single. So there are a lot of different subsystems. And finally, we arrived at this architecture. And now you see why this is so complex, because the light has to go through different mirrors. It had to match with the cavity of the mirror or the shape of the mirrors. One interesting thing about LIGO, if I ask you, if I want to put this thing on this table, and let's say this is my mirror, and I want to make sure that this doesn't move, what should I do? Glue it, good. Anyone else? Good. Another solution? Anyone else? magnet, oh, so I need to bring, oh, that's, I didn't anticipate that one. So I get magnets and put them around them. Any other? But for the magnet levitation, do I need to put this on some base and just hold it by magnets? Okay, that's the word I was looking for. Exactly. So basically, we need an active damping mechanism. And the easiest the easiest way to do that is put it on a pendulum. So if you have ever observed a pendulum, pendulum moves with a certain frequency. I think 2 pi root L over G, or 1 over 2 pi. I think it's 2 pi root L over G. That's the natural frequency of the pendulum. If you were to move the pendulum by hand by that frequency, there will be a huge oscillation. But if you go beyond that, the oscillation, even if you move the pendulum, the actual pendulum will not move. And that's why these huge mirrors are actually not bolted down. They are not glued, because if you glue them, this means whatever the motion of the table is will be transferred to them. That's why they are isolated from this by using pendulums. And this is the reason we could only detect gravitational waves which are more than 10 hertz. Because depending upon how long the fibers are, and these 40 kilogram mirrors are actually hanging by fiber optics. So those by very tiny fibers. So those tiny fibers, they look something like, and all the optics goes in vacuum in chambers like this. So all these mirrors are basically go in here. That's me when I was young. And that's me working on the LIGO. So at 2008, I was at Hanford site, and I actually stopped by at Dr. Tanvi's place, and I actually passed through Seattle. And this is how inside of LIGO looks like in 2008. So we are putting optics together. So basically, before we even go to the suspensions, there is something called isolation. That we get from, so this is more or less, you can think of this as a shock absorber system. So the whole table is on very heavy duty shocks so that the motion of the Earth is not coupled to the mirrors. And what we actually measure is actually the gravitational wave. And there are like 4 different mirrors to control just one mirror. Another interesting thing about LIGO, that the mirrors that you are trying to detect your motion for, you, how are you going to orient them? Because the light has to go 4 kilometer long and come back. So it's difficult if the mirror is pointing slightly different direction at 4 kilometer away, is going to, instead of going to the Hanford, it will go to Livingston. So you need to maintain that isolation. So to control that, you cannot touch it. How can you control it? What they do is they actually put 4 small mirrors in, 4 small magnets, so they do use magnets. So you, and then there are counter magnets on that. So without touching them, by controlling the amount of the electric current that goes through these magnetic coil, you can control these mirrors so that there is the isolation doesn't break down. And that's how they actually look like. These mirrors are absolutely the best mirrors you can think of in the world. They are so pure that their absorption is less than 0.5 ppm, like one part in 1 million. That's how much less energy they absorb. They are super polished. If you look at them, I guarantee you, if your face was right in front of them, you will not see anything in front of you. You will not think that there is a mirror in front of you. That's how super polished they are. You will not see any defect in them. And even from here, you can see very clearly, basically the laser is 1 micron, so that's why the coating that we have, it does not interfere with the visible light that we have. But they're incredibly clean mirrors that are being used. I guess I'll skip the cavity part. This is how we mentioned about that we operate at the dark fringe, so you maintain the distance between them. Whenever the gravity wave will come, the photo detector will either, instead of 0, it will measure something, and then you will know that there is a phase difference between them. Another interesting thing is that whenever the mirror, for you who are more mathematically inclined, if you have a certain wavelength of light going into the mirror, whenever the mirror shakes, what it creates is sideband. So it basically creates additional frequency. And that's exactly what LIGO does. So if you were to take the Fourier transform of this equation, you will see that instead of the carrier light, you see additional light at different frequency. And that's how LIGO detects them. So you cannot detect the main signal. You actually have to do the Fourier transform. This is what the curve in the main paper was looked like. And this is what I meant by 60 hertz joke. And you can think of this as a background or as a noise. So there is a huge noise at 60 hertz. So anything at 60 hertz is very difficult to measure. And then there are these spikes in the noise that basically comes from different systems, different electrical systems, different data acquisition systems. But the rest of this, anything above that, if whenever the gravitational wave will come, and if you take the Fourier transform, you will see that the signal will go up. And that's how we know that the gravitational waves have arrived. This is the actual signal that was, this is not the Fourier transform, but it is the pure raw signal that you will extract from the Fourier transform. So initially, it started with at zero, there was no signal. Then the signal started coming in, and then signal frequency increased. And then this is the exact point where they coalesce together, they merge together, and then and then the gravitational wave magnitude died back again. And this is the frequency, if you want to see how the frequency started. So the frequency, initial frequency was about 32 hertz. It passed 64 hertz, and at the maximum point, it was somewhere around 200 hertz. Why this frequency is important? This frequency is important because not only it tells you what was the mass of those two gravitational, those two black holes that merged together, it also tells you what was the distance between them and where did they actually come from. And that's how, using this equation that comes from the Einstein equation, you can see the frequency dependency. If you apply a filter to it, if you apply curve fitting, from the curve fitting, you can estimate what was the mass of those objects and how far they were from. And that's how LIGO knows they were roughly about 1.3 billion light years away. If you look on the sky, this is where it comes from. And here you will see that this is the probability of where the signal comes from. It's an arc. It's not a point. Most of you who have worked with the cell phone or GPS, it can pinpoint you exactly. The reason it can pinpoint you exactly is because they have more than two. They have three towers, for example. What you call the principle of triangulation. Using the principle of triangulation, you can detect where your position is, and you can also detect from the from where the signal comes from. If you don't have triangulation, what you can do, the best you can do is come up with an arc that this is somewhere here where the two black holes were merging, but you cannot pinpoint one single point. And that's exactly the reason why there is an international collaboration to come up with the okay. And this is the reason why there are interferometers planned all over the world. Because if you have the base is longer, then you can pinpoint it with more accuracy. Oh, by the way, initially there were three interferometers in US, two in Hanford, one in Livingston. But now, a few years ago, it was decided to better able to detect the gravitational wave. The third will be sent to different country. And there was negotiation at high level that which country will support the construction. And finally, India came up with the required amount of money. Now the third interferometer will actually be installed in India somewhere in 2020 or that time frame. I think I should speed up. I wanted to talk a little bit about data acquisition, but I think I don't have time. I'll talk about data acquisition hardware. Basically use PCI Express for those who are interested in data acquisition aspects for it. 16 to 18 bit multi-channel sampling that we do. We actually measure about we can detect different signals. So we just not only detect the actual signal, but we monitor about thousands and thousands of different sensors. The reason we monitor these sensors is because so that we know that nothing happened, like there was no shaking, no one was actually moving somewhere, to isolate those effects, acoustic effect, a logging effect close by. LIGO monitors thousands and thousands of channels. And then they cross-correlate these with the gravitational waves so to make sure that this was not an isolated event coming from some local event. Unfortunately, LIGO doesn't use Windows because the timing accuracy that's needed is sub-microsecond. So LIGO uses a Linux system where we have we monitor all these channels on sub-microsecond levels. I guess here I mentioned there's about 300,000 channels that are measured. Basically, there are clusters at Caltech which actually do the data analysis. There is another project that you may have heard of, Einstein at Home, where LIGO asks for different people to sign up, and when they do, then your CPU power, when you are not using your computer, can be used for calculations. Because detecting LIGO, especially doing the data analysis part, requires a lot of power. So basically, so all we are looking for is a signal like this, or signals like this. Burst signal, basically, this is the method where, so you get all this data, terabytes and terabytes of data, and you need to find out if there is a gravitational wave signal between them. So the first thing you do, you take the Fourier transform and see if there is any excess power anywhere. If you see that the signal jumped, then you know that there is some kind of gravitational wave there, and then you start at the exact same moment, you start looking at the second detector, and then try to compare if the signal that was detected at Hanford and the signal that was detected at Livingston, they were similar in approach or not. So there are a lot of tests. These are actually mentioned in the main detection paper that you can see and learn a little bit more about the data acquisition part, that how the data acquisition part is done. So you use all kind of match filtering where you can predict what kind of signal you are looking for. You cross-correlate with signals from two different observatories, and then you can, here is the familiar signal again. But let me point out that the signal that you are looking at, so this one, this signal is from Livingston, this signal is from Hanford, where what they have done, they have time shifted it accordingly. The time difference was about 8 milliseconds. Their time difference also tells you where the direction was, because 10 milliseconds is the interval that the light will take more or less a straight path from Livingston to Louisiana. If the signal time difference between them is less than 10 milliseconds, then the signal must be coming from some direction. So that's how you can detect where the signal was coming from. Now, my personal involvement in LIGO, that what I did from 2005 to 2010, I was at University of Florida. Most of my work was, these were my colleagues. And out of these, three professors, they were my postdoctoral advisor. I had the best time ever. I think these are the best years of my life when I worked at LIGO. Coming to industry definitely pays more, but you lose something in translation. But anyhow, I had great time working with this, especially with Dr. Ridesy, who is now the LIGO lab director, and he's the one who announced the gravitational wave detection. Okay, some of you might have heard this. So the reason I brought this, that although I stopped working for LIGO in 2010, but and they have a policy that your name does not appear after 1 year you leave. But the work that I did, they still remembered the work that I contributed to. So because of that work, my name was put on the detection paper, which came out on 11. And this is probably the high point of my career at this point. So there were out of 1,000 people, there were 20, 30 people who don't work at LIGO, but their work was considered significant enough that they were put on the detection paper. And the reason, the main reason I was in there was because of this paper that we published in 2008 with Professor Guido Müller, where we proposed the optical layout. You saw that crazy mirrors that were all over the place. So someone had to come up with what would be the radius of curvature of these mirrors, what would be the distance between them. That's what I was doing. And we came up with this idea that there will be more different cavities around them, and what will be the configuration of the cavities. That's the work that I did in at LIGO. And the current LIGO is based upon this design. And the good thing is that the design that we proposed, the concept of the design that we proposed, was adopted worldwide. Another interferometer in Australia that they were planning, they will use the same concept, just different numbers. And then the Italian version, or French, Italian, European version of LIGO, they are also using the same design that we proposed. If you are an optical engineer, these were the basically, so we came up with what would be the distances between them, what would be the radius of curvature between them, and the reflectivity of the mirrors, what kind of frequency should we use to control them, and so on. So I wanted to show you this also, because this is an interesting fact, that the amount of light that's bouncing back and forth between these two mirrors is about half a megawatt, about 500 kilowatt light going back and forth between these two mirrors. A little while ago, I mentioned that LIGO uses 200 watt. That's why we tested it, but that's outside the cavity. So you start with about 200 watt, then you put one mirror in there, and then you have these cavities inside. And then finally, the signal cavity. When the light goes in the cavity, people who are familiar with cavity, when the light reaches the cavity or goes through a cavity, light makes multiple bounces. Because of multiple bounces, if you start with 200 watt, when the second time it will bounce, you get 400 watt. And so this way, the cavity light builds up. So from 200 watt, here it's about 2 kilowatt of light. And then from here, inside the main mirrors, it's about 500, 600 kilowatt of light. This much amount of light is so much that it actually physically, light actually create more in the mirror. It bends the mirror. It bends the mirror very slightly. But so there's something called radiation pressure. And this was not a known fact before LIGO. So the scientists who are working on it, they find out that if so much light is hitting a mirror, it can actually physically deform the mirror. And that's what you are seeing. And when a mirror deforms because of mechanical modes, it will go into resonance, and the light will go out of lock. So you need to take care of these. So this was very, at least for me, this was very interesting phenomena, that light actually physically changing the shape of the mirror, not just burning it or anything, physically changing the structure of the mirror. That's how LIGO starts. So there is a stabilized laser that we use, very sophisticated, that comes from Germany. This is the first part that I designed, where we put different mirrors in there, basically shape the light. Then from here, light goes to this chamber, which is in vacuum. And all these crazy stuff is basically these different mirrors. And this is how the beam size goes through. When I was at LIGO, people will remember, whenever they need any information about the beam size, they will ask me. I will remember all the beam sizes at different mirrors at that time. I have forgotten some, but basically that's how the beam size starts. So the initial beam of the 200 watt beam is about half a centimeter, about 0.5 millimeter. Then it goes to about a millimeter by using lenses. Then from millimeter, it goes to 2.4 millimeter at this mirror, and then from this mirror, it goes about 6 centimeter. So when the light actually hits the main mirror, it's already 6 centimeter in diameter. So these mirrors are like 300 millimeter in diameter. This was the stuff that I was mentioning before, the photo that you saw, that it basically the light, so much light can go back and kill the laser. To prevent that, we have something called Faraday isolator. And this, when during 2008, 2009, I actually had the opportunity to install them in the vacuum, and then do work on the thermal modeling. As I mentioned, that the light was about half a megawatt of light. This much light also changes the radius of curvature. So I was involved in predicting how much deformation will happen because of this high amount of laser power. This is.
The light hits them, so they must be warm enough. But is there a microphone?
Very, very, very good question. So there is something called, we actually don't cool it. But there was an experiment that was done where the idea was, this did not take place, but the idea was that you will put something very close or next to the mirror and the light will radiate. That's another thing that people, science has predicted, but no one has actually done it. It has not been proven. So there was some crazy idea that you can use radiative cooling to cool the mirror, but that didn't go forward. But instead, what LIGO did was that we will take diamond cuts diamond. So we will bring the heat, we will take care of the heat by putting more heat on it. And this is how you will take care of that. Let's say this is my mirror, and there is high amount of light passing through it. The light will absorb more, so the mirror will deform like this. And to compensate that, what we do is we put more light at the ends or at the barrel of the optics. If you do that, then if this was the distorted optic, then undistorted, then when you put more heat on it, you will, because you are putting more heat here, less, then this will compensate and the mirror will come back to its original shape. So you took care of the front surface. But it produces more problem. Now it will create a negative lens in there. To compensate that, you put an active, another piece of optics in there, and then you shine an extra light at an angle. When you do that, then it will create a bump. So this bump will cancel this bump. So, so this way, you will create, you can cancel the effect. But at the same, so actually, this actually shows that, so this is another experiment I was working on, that we wanted to do it adaptively. So by adaptively, we said that instead of using one heater, we will put four different heaters around the optic, and you can control the amount of heating. By controlling the amount of heating, you can create different bumps in different directions. So depending on how much the absorption of the mirror was, how good the cooling was, you can actively control the compensation. Or you cannot cool it, but what you can do, whatever the effects of heating because of the laser is, you can compensate them. This was another interesting idea. I didn't make it through to LIGO, but I really liked it. So one day we were drinking coffee and thinking about how we can dump 200 watt laser. Because whenever the laser is not working or the interferometer is not logged, light comes back and you need to dump 200 watt in vacuum. As you mentioned that cooling something in vacuum is a big challenge because if there is no vacuum, there is no radiation, the radiation is very less, so the amount of heat that's, it basically builds up. So one of the idea was, someone came up with the idea, why don't we put a coffee cup in there and heat the coffee? So initially we thought maybe it's, we took it as a joke, but the idea had merit. So we discussed that what we can do, instead of putting coffee, let's put some water in there and see if we can heat the water by using this 200 watt laser. So what we came up with was, these are the cells that people use in chemistry all the time. These are called chemical cells. So you can inject water from one end and then the water comes out from the other end. So what we did, we took this cell, we put very high quality fused silica mirrors in there, sealed it, and then the light would come in. And then the trick was we actually had to put a few drops of India ink or black ink because pure water does not absorb energy. If you put a little bit of black ink into it, it absorbs tremendous amount of energy. And that's exactly what we found. So we shine 200 watt light laser on it. These are the commercially available beam dumps. There is some light reflected back. But from this, what we used to call coffee maker, the light will come in. There will be very small amount of light coming back. All the light will be absorbed. So we actually tested that so we bought a fish tank, put a motor in around it so that the water can actually circulate, put a mirror in there, and then actually measure how much light is coming back and how much light is being absorbed. So that was a very fun experiment. Some old memories, so I had some good old time at LIGO. What's next? So apart from now that LIGO has detected a gravitational wave, it doesn't stop. Right now, LIGO is actually not working at its full potential. It's still not using all the amount of laser light that's available. So it will go on increasingly. So we'll gradually increase the amount of power that the LIGO is currently using. The more the power, the further we can look into the universe, the more gravitational waves Yes, please.
Yeah, you mentioned that with gravitational wave detection, you can detect further than with light detection.
Yes.
But if they travel with the speed of light, right, can you detect further?
The light itself or the gravitational waves? The light does not come back. It is so much redshifted that it's difficult to get anything beyond that. Light has certain absorption, so the when the light through passes through this much atmosphere, you will not get anything back.
Okay, so it's because of the absorption.
Yes.
So the main interferometer, is this a continuous wave mode, or is this some kind of pulse?
It's a continuous move. There is modulation involved, but that modulation is only to put side bands on it so that you can control the cavity. So, okay, never mind. Okay, so the question was, is the laser that's being used for LIGO, is it continuous wave or modulated? So the answer is that the light is actually, the laser is continuous CW, but there is modulation on the cavity. There was one slide that I skipped. The way to control the cavity, the light in the cavity, is that you put some modulation on it. This is the main CW light at 1 micron. So we use 45 micron, 45 megahertz, 9 megahertz light. It creates side bands. Side bands are actually reflect, does not go inside the cavity, and side bands are reflected from this. Then by multiplying the main carrier with the side band, you can actually know whether the mirrors are aligned or not. So modulation is used just to align the cavities.
So you mentioned earlier that like with the equations, you can detect how far back the cosmic event can happen.
Yes.
So now, like, if this supports for an experiment, there are two cosmic events. One was a billion years back, and one was half a billion years back. But the events are totally identical.
Mm-hmm.
They're exactly the same event. So would they not be generating the same gravitational waves?
If the distance between... it depends on if those two, yes, they will be generating the same gravitational wave, but when they will arrive to the Earth, that will be different.
You said the gravitational waves don't change as they reach the Earth from the Earth.
Yes.
So these
gravitational waves will pass, and then now we cannot detect them anymore. So the first one arrived, went away, so we detected it. Like half a billion year later, if something exactly like that happened, half a billion year later, LIGO will detect it. Or did I understood your question correctly?
See, when we think of the universe, it's spread at different years.
Yes.
So it could happen potentially that both events reach us at the same point of time, just because of how far they are from us.
Yes.
So then would LIGO be able to make our
decision? Okay. So that's where the triangulation comes in, because if these two events happen at different time, then if you have multiple detectors, three or four detectors, depending upon which direction they come in, they will actually you can detect them from which direction are they coming, and from there you will be able to predict. But it's a very good question. I don't know whether LIGO actually looks for multiple events at the same time or not. I'm not sure.
In the 1700s, I forget the name of the scientist, but he measured the force of gravity between cannonball-sized objects with a torsional balance.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and people haven't seen it. The torsional balance is two cannonballs connected by a rod, suspended by a piece of steel or cap cut with a mirror on it. If you were to take a bowling ball or set up your Cavendish balance and then take another mass and put it on a spring and get it going about 100 hertz or something, eventually, according to Cavendish, you measure 100 hertz on that receiver.
Uh-huh.
Is that a qualitatively different wave than what LIGO
is? It's similar. Actually, someone actually tried that. In 1960s, there was a scientist, I don't remember his full name, his last name was Webb, and there are something called Webb, I guess so. So he tried to do that. I don't think so it was successful, because the magnitude, the amount of gravitational wave, the magnitude is so small, you cannot really come up with a scheme like that. But people have actually proposed that. Okay. So apart from now, yes, please. Sure.
So you said that there's also one observatory in Italy.
Yes.
Here,
yep.
Was it the creation at the moment?
Unfortunately not. So they're also going through construction and so basically they are a little bit, they lag in terms of time. They started later. So right now they are going through something called advanced Virgo. So it was not operational at that time. Otherwise it would have been great that you could actually pinpoint exactly where the signal was coming from. So I was mentioning, yes please.
So I have a question. The nature or the principle operation of the experiment is it sort of suggests that the speed of light in the vacuum isn't actually constant. That's how you can basically measure a phase difference. So I was wondering if that's true, then if you had a gravity wave traveling through space and you were to shoot a laser beam along the gravity wave, would the parts of that laser beam that were riding in the crests go faster or slower than the parts of the laser beam going to the drops? And could you actually see the speed of light?
It does. Actually, one of the thing that I did not mention here before was Einstein's general theory of relativity also predicts that the light coming from distant planets is redshifted because of the gravity. So if you were to able, if the light was actually coming from those, if we were to able to detect the light that was coming from those black holes when they were merging together, depending upon the intensity, depending on the mass, you could actually detect that the light, the frequency of light is shifted.
Okay, and then I have a kind of corollary to that. Do we have any space probes out there right now that have a laser beam pointed at Earth on them? And if we look at that laser beam, will we see any variation?
That's where the next phase will come in. That's one of the thing where LIGO is basically working at. So what LIGO wants is that we should be able to tell the astronomers where to look for. So if we detect a gravitational wave signal, we can, so LIGO is working with other observatories, optical observatories, and tell them, oh, we think something is happening in that direction, and there's a collaboration being set up so that they will be able to pinpoint their telescope in those directions to see if something interesting is happening there or not.
Okay, I guess I was asking about some probe that we've already sent out. If it has a laser beam on it pointing at Earth, if we could look at that laser beam light and see it vary in gravity.
I think so. Experiment plan like that, but there is a sister project to LIGO, which is called LISA, or it was called LISA before. Now it's called ELISA because NASA actually pulled out. So the idea was we will have gravitational interferometer in space. What it shows was that there will be three interferometer so that you can cancel out. So LIGO people also wants to, there were a lot of scientists involved in LIGO that were also working on LISA, but during 2013, 2012 or so, the funding was cut and the project was, European took over the project. That's also after detecting the gravitational wave, LIGO, some of the scientists or some of the people involved in LIGO are trying to see if they can resurrect this this project again. So basically after, this is just the first detection. This is just the beginning. Once we have detected and the gravitational waves, then we could start working on increasing the sensitivity. Then we will know more about what kind of events happen in the universe, and we will basically be able to understand black hole generation and how the black holes are formed.
So right now, there's a lot of dust and material and light and stuff interfering with the way we look into the center of the galaxy.
Mm-hmm.
So with gravitational waves, can we actually look through the center of the galaxy?
That's one of the advantages of looking through gravitational waves, because they are not absorbed by a different mass or different dust that's around there. So it basically just passes through them, changes them whenever it interacts with the mass and passes through them uninhibited.
And can LIGO only currently detect like large events like neutron stars and black hole collisions within like, and what's the range of that? And how often do those events happen? Like how long do we have to wait for the next LIGO
now,
signal?
Actually, LIGO was working since 2001, did not detect any gravitational wave for the last 9-10 years, whenever it was not operational for the whole period, but it did not detect it. The reason was the sensitivity is not enough. Now that the sensitivity is 10 times, I think people are expecting that they will detect signals, maybe 20, 30 signals a year, 40 signals a year.
And it has to be two objects interacting, right? It can't be just be a type A supernova or something like
that? It could be. But the problem, I guess I mentioned this, to detect that, the frequency, if there is only one mass involved, most probably the frequency is going to be smaller, so that LIGO may not be able to detect it. LIGO starts from, if you go back to the curve that we have, Where is my favorite sensitivity curve? Okay, this curve. So basically, it will tell you that below 20 hertz you cannot detect. So or below 10 hertz you cannot detect. So if you if the mass is higher, the frequency will be lower. The earlier chart that I mentioned, then LIGO will not be able to detect it. But if there was space, the main reason is because of the because of the motion on the Earth, that the Earth shakes, and because of the thermal, because of the suspension, the mirrors are suspended, so you cannot isolate them fully. So that's why you cannot detect below 10 hertz. But those kind of phenomena.
So, sorry to interrupt. So I think if we have any questions, we can take them after the talk because some of you may have to leave. So let's let Professor wrap up the talk, and then he's going to be here for taking any questions.
So as you mentioned, so LIGO can detect only up to 10 hertz. But if there was something in space, you could actually see supernovas forming, neutron stars forming, and just once. Another way, when gravitational waves are generated, if the object is not symmetrical and it's rotating, even then then the gravitational waves are generated. For example, Earth and Sun, the combination of Earth and Sun actually does produce gravitational waves, but the amount of the amount of energy that's released in gravitational wave is very small. And just by releasing, if we only consider the gravitational wave that Earth and Sun are generating gravitational wave, it will take about 10 raised to the power 12 years, many billions of years for the Earth to actually coalesce with Sun. Before that, a lot of things will happen. But because of the mass of the Earth and the Sun, the amount of gravitational wave that's generated is very small. So if that was true, if there was a mission in the space, because in the mission in the space, the Earth does not shake, so you don't have vibration, you automatically have very nice vacuum. You don't have to take about a week. By the way, when LIGO is operational, if anything happens inside the vacuum, or you have to change a mirror, or you have to move a mirror physically, it takes about a week to create the full vacuum over the 4 kilometer long arm. So that's why whenever we are designing any optics that goes inside, we make sure that we are not the ones, whichever subsystem is working on, that they are not the one because of whom they have to open up LIGO. And this was actually very fortunate that the paper that was detected, the LIGO was not supposed to start until the week after, but somehow they were a little bit ahead of their schedule and they started taking data. They detected gravitational wave on September 14th. I think they started 3 or 4 days before. So if we are not, they had not started taking data 3 or 4 days early, then there will be no gravitational wave detection and I will not be here. Then there are underground detectors. Another reason to go underground is that as you go deeper and deeper in Earth, the amount of shaking that happens because of the Earth reduces, and you can better detect. You can detect lower frequency. So there are certain projects which are actually employed where people want to put detectors underground. This reminds me of interesting fact that when I used to work at Living, so we used to go back and forth between Livingston and Hanford. And in Livingston, in around 2009 time frame, some genius from the government thought that the area around Livingston is actually very green. You saw a lot of trees around there. Someone thought maybe it's a good place that you can cut trees. So they actually did a contract with some company, and they were able to log, and they started logging the trees. And during the day, the LIGO had to stop because someone was cutting trees around there. I guess that's my last slide. I thank all of you for being here for such a lively discussion, and for Dr. Tanvir Iqbal for inviting me here, and from his company. If you have any questions, please feel free. I really enjoyed my talk, and one last thing. The topic of my talk was Melody of the Universe, and this is how it sounds. So the first one, this is the stochastic background that you're hearing. This will be two very massive neutron stars colliding with each other. The first one was just Big Bang or other things. That's the chirp. That's when the neutron stars collide together. That's somewhat lower mass, so the frequency is a little bit less than that. This is another one. So basically what I'm doing, I'm putting how the black hole merger will sound to you if the mass will become smaller and smaller. So the detection that LIGO made, roughly the size of those black hole was 30 times the size of 30 times the mass of Earth, mass of Sun. And these are actually calculated. People have come up with these waveforms. And this one is a continuous one. And that is one of the examples. If the mass is not symmetrical, there's single mass, it could emit gravitational waves, which will be single monotony. This is the kind of detection that LIGO has made. So this signal is closer to what LIGO actually has made. This is, again, the background. And finally, this one is the burst, single burst. Something big happens, supernova, so you will, or burst. And this is the actual signal that LIGO detected. And finally, this is the famous signal that's detected at Hanford and Livingston. So you see four different sounds. The first two sounds are actually not frequency shifted. They are actually how you will hear them if the magnitude was higher. The last two signals, when you see more frequency, they upshifted the frequency so that you can hear it easily. So all the signals that I mentioned, there is a group called General Numerical Relativity. They actually take Einstein's theory, put the equations, and apply it to different masses, and then come up with all these waveforms. And these are the waveforms that LIGO actually searched for. So we have a huge amount of data. There are two modes that LIGO operates. In one mode, you just look for something other than the background. In another mode, they actively look for different waveforms, which scientists have predicted that this is how the waveform will look like. And that's where all the matched filtering concepts and correlation, cross-correlation comes from. But the biggest reason that LIGO is sure that this came from the gravitational wave sources is because of the correlation between two different detectors, and that the signals basically, if you look at the signal and then correlate it with the actual what's predicted by Einstein's theory, the residue is very small. They fit so nicely. Whenever they saw it for the first time, that people knew that the gravitational waves have been detected. Okay, thank you. This concludes my presentation.